Welcome, everyone. I want to start on time today so that we have time to listen to all of these presentations and especially to have discussion at the end. My name is Nancy Kinner, and I am at the University of New Hampshire Coastal Response Research Center, and I have the great pleasure of moderating today's session, which we think is the first session at AAAS on the Deepwater Horizon, and particularly what we'd like to talk today about is the legacy of that event and what the new science that's come out of it has brought to bear and how that might affect policy for marine oil exploration and development going forward. We've got three terrific speakers, Dr. Rita Colwell, who needs no introduction, Dr. Michael Schluter from Germany, and Dr. Steve Murawski from Florida, and they'll each be talking. If you can imagine back to pre-2010, people in the oil spill world, such as myself, focused on this statistic, that oil tanker transport was getting safer, that if you looked over time, especially in the U.S. since the 1990, open 90, the number of oil tanker spills and the volume was going down greatly. What we weren't thinking about is so much is that the amount of drilling in the Gulf of Mexico was going up, and these little yellow circles show you the rigs that were in the Gulf. And in one site in particular, this one right here, where you can see this little black dot, there was some very interesting drilling going on. That drilling was with the Deepwater Horizon semi-submersible rig, and they were drilling to an oil reservoir that was 5,500 meters below surface. And the rig itself was state-of-the-art, had drilled some of the deepest wells in the Gulf, and was owned by Transocean and was leased to BP to do this drilling. In April of 2010, there was a blowout at this well. 11 people were killed on the rig, and it resulted, as you all remember, in an 86-day uncontrolled release from the well, and about 200 million gallons of oil released into the Gulf. It was a seminal event that changed our thinking forever about drilling, especially in the U.S. Lest you think that in the interim we have done any less deep water drilling in the country, you should be dissuaded of that view by looking at this particular graphic, where you can see that the lease depth has been increasing continuously since 1996, and the most recent data from 2014 shows that we're now down close to 3,000 meters deep for some of the wells that are being drilled. So this drives us to ask the question, what do we need to know to effectively regulate and respond to accidents associated with this ultra-deep water drilling and production? And there are many questions we could ask about baselines that we would need to understand contamination in the sediments, about response measures for these very deep wells and how we would actually work with them, what are the resources at risk, how would those spills in the, not only the surface, but as the oil moved to the surface, but how would the subsurface plumes move? And then what are the environmental consequences of the different types of measures that would be used for cleanup, things like dispersants and in situ burning? And then finally, can ultra-deep drilling and the production be accomplished with greatly reduced risks for environmental change? Is that really possible? So today we're going to hear from three speakers, as I mentioned, Dr. Rita Colwell, who has been heading up the efforts by the Gulf of Mexico Research Initiative, and she's going to talk about that partnership between industry, academia, and government. Michael Schluter from Hamburg Technical University, who's going to be talking about some of the implications of the pressure and temperature conditions on the behavior of deep water blowouts. And then finally, Dr. Steve Murawski of the University of South Florida, who's going to be talking about the ecological implications, not only of the deep water horizon, but how does that compare to the 1979 Ixtox blowout? So without further ado, I will turn this over to Dr. Rita Colwell.
Thank you very much, Nancy. It's a pleasure to have the opportunity to discuss this program, which started literally with a phone call. After April 2010, when I, as all the rest of us, saw on the news that this terrible accident had occurred, I was asked, I got a phone call from Dr. Williams, the chief scientist of BP, about the middle of May in 2010. Dr. Williams asked me if I would consider heading up a research program that the BP company was going to establish. They were going to provide $500 million over a 10-year period, and they would like to have this focused on an independent research program. My questions to Dr. Williams were, first of all, will this be truly independent? In other words, is this going to be a program that's going to be run really as a science program and not as an arm of BP? And the answer was yes. And then I also asked, would I be able to pull together my own team, and could we operate it precisely as the National Science Foundation would do? And again, the answer was yes. So my experience is, having been the director of the National Science Foundation and having run that organization for 6 years, it was possible then for me to be able to establish the research program. Let's see if I got the research program in the Gulf.
Which way do you want to go?
Toward
this way here, if you want to.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay, good. So we established a very small team of about four or five members of the board, of course, naively in retrospect, to be able to run a $500 million program over 10 years with five people on the board didn't really, in retrospect, make much sense. At the time, it did. In any case, we ended up with a 20-person board, but the critical point and message that I would like to convey today is that what we have achieved in the Gulf of Mexico with this funding provided by industry, with complete independence, but essentially agreement on what the mission would be and what the focus would be. So it's not really applied research. I would call it directed research. But allowing those who do the research to be totally independent, to publish freely, without any kind of oversight. And it has, I think, in retrospect, worked extremely well. So the mission was to establish an independent research program, study the effects of the Deepwater Horizon incident, and to assure that we could develop findings that would lead to improved spill mitigation, detection of the oil, characterizing it chemically, physically, and its effects ecologically, and also to provide advice on remediation. So the goal was to make sure that society in general, the layperson, would understand what we are doing and how the research that we do provides better understanding and improvement of our response to spills. We agreed with BP on research themes, and we established a memorandum of understanding, namely that we would study the physical distribution, that is, how the oil disperses and how it dissolves in water, and the contaminants that are associated with treating a spill. We would also study the chemical evolution and the degradation by microorganisms and higher organisms in the system. That we would look at the environmental effects, the ecology of the animals and the vegetation, and also of the effects on humans, public health aspects, and then try to develop some technology to improve the response and mitigation. So this, the research themes, the mission, and the goal were agreed upon. The memorandum of agreement was signed, and then the initiative was launched completely independently. The research board comprises scientists, for example, Dr. Linen, who is the head of the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, folks, Dana Yeager, who is a deep sea physical oceanographer from Woods Hole, Cecily Maritzen, who has done a lot of work with oil companies in Norway, as well as with the universities there, and then Jürgen Ruhlkoder, who is from the University of Oldenburg in Germany, again, an individual who has done a lot of work on research on oil, and then a variety of colleagues from the Gulf institutions, as well as from institutions elsewhere in the U.S. and overseas. Dr. Singer and Dr. Sumayel are physicians, or at least Dr. Singer works in public health, and Dr. Sumaya actually is a medical doctor who practices in Texas. So it's a good mix of individuals. We decided in our first meeting that we would operate precisely according to the National Academy of Science and the National Science Foundation and Science Board. So we have peer review of all the publications and peer review of all the proposals submitted to do research in the Gulf. The mechanism is that we would design requests for proposals, put out the call, the response, and we've had hundreds of response proposals, that we would then have independent reviews and then meetings of panels, just as the National Science Foundation conducts its evaluation and selection of research. And all of us are clear about not having a conflict of interest. We are not involved, those of us on the board or the staff, are not involved in any of the science, and do we have in any way any investment in what is being done in the research. We have all researchers, all of those in the universities and the research institutions, must comply with the National Academies of Science rules and obligations of scientists. And then the researchers will conduct independent, objective work with no influence from BP. And the publications will go into peer-reviewed journals, independently peer-reviewed, again, with no pre-approval or any attempt to prevent publication of the findings, whether they're what BP would want to know or not. The fact is, we deal with science and we'll publish good science. So, we have expended to date $350 million, roughly, of the $500 million. We've had a series of requests for proposals, RFPs, and I'm very pleased that we have 42 states, 278 universities and academic research institutes, and also it's international, 18 countries participate in the research. As of last December, almost 1,000 peer-reviewed publications, book chapters, and 2,000, more than 2,000 scientific presentations of all of the findings, posters, and a total of about 3,400 people. And I'm most proud of the fact that we are training in the various institutions about 1,000 students. The journals are all peer-reviewed journals. These are just a sampling of the journals that the research has been published in, predominantly, as one would expect, oceanography and environmental journals, where the audience, of course, is interested in what we're finding. The distribution of the grants are not restricted in any way geographically. The partnership in general is with the major institutions in the Gulf states of Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida, so that the connections, it's, in a sense, one can consider it as capacity building as well in the Gulf region with the collaborations throughout the country and overseas. The other important legacy that I think is critical is that we decided from the very beginning that all data would go into a data repository in a format that would be accessible by everybody. So from the very beginning, and in fact, we have teeth in the requirement, you don't get your last payment until the data have been deposited. So that very nicely ensures that all the data gets deposited. And the Gulf of Mexico Heart Institute handles and maintains the data. And our program ends in 2020, but we are forward funding the Heart Institute and the Gulf of Mexico Research Initiative Data Center at the Grid C for the next 10 years. So even though the program will end in 2020, it'll be funded for the data to be available to anyone, and that's all the data, for the next 10 years. And we hope that it'll be picked up subsequently as other data are added in that period of time so that it becomes a massive database of environmental data related to oil and oil spills. The kinds of research projects that we've had underway, you'll hear a little bit today, but just a sort of broad coverage, the role of the Mississippi River in the transport using both the oversight by airplane as well as boat and buoy markers, being able to understand how it has been transported with currents, and then the pathways of the oil being absorbed in the environment in the what we call marine snow and also taken up by the animals. And a lot of work has been done, which is quite fascinating, on the droplet formation that occurs as the oil moves into the water column, especially under pressure at the depths in the system. A lot of this work has been done in collaboration with physical oceanographers at Woods Hole, Scripps, in the Gulf, and overseas. And I think now we have a very elegant understanding of how oil gets dispersed, and a great deal of discussion about dispersants that were added. In fact, the Gulf of Mexico Research Initiative has just funded the National Academy of Science about $300,000, along with other funding provided by the National Academy, to do a major 2 to 3 year study on the effects of dispersants, because it is indeed a fairly controversial topic, just what happens to the oil as it is affected by the dispersant and then disperses much further in the system and taken up by animals with potential harmful effects. The fate of oil, of course, has been very intensively studied, not only what happens when it hits the coast of the Gulf, but also what happens to the animals and to the vegetation. And certainly, studies have been done to determine what the effects in the deep water systems. The studies on what to do when there is a spill have again been really important. And the work that's been done, particularly by the University of Florida, with overflights, a massive buoy system, which, by the way, turned out to be very effective because the buoys had been had been put into the system, and we were able to track the path of the hurricanes that hit Louisiana and provide tremendous assistance to the Weather Bureau because we had this massive array of buoys in the Gulf of Mexico. The research on oil degradation is particularly fascinating because of the uptake of the various animals, the deep sea animals, as well as the fish, shellfish, and the shore animals in the Gulf. Now, I want to make a point that really is critical. It's important when you carry out research, particularly in a high visibility program like this, that you spend a lot of time and effort to tell the public exactly what you're doing. So from the very beginning, We contracted with the Sea Grant College Program in the Gulf, and programs of meetings in the communities to describe and discuss what's going on, to hear from the community individuals about their concerns of the oil and the effects on the communities. We contracted with the Smithsonian so that all of the research that's published is available through the Smithsonian Ocean Portal, which reaches hundreds of schools and thousands of school children. We have a website. We've also developed documentaries of how the science is done. And one of them, the Dispatches from the Gulf, has been shown on the local PBS stations in the Gulf of Mexico. It was narrated by Matt Damon, which is, of course, another good attraction for people to watch it. And we're in the process of doing a second documentary. But this kind of outreach is really critical, especially at a time when science is under duress and when facts are being challenged with, I hate to even use the word alternative facts, there's no such thing. It's a fact or it isn't a fact. In any case, we've made a great serious effort to keep the public informed and to be available on the part of all of our scientists to talk with the communities and describe what's underway. So we're spending a good deal of time now incorporating the findings in a synthesis of the chemistry, physics, biology, ecology, public health, to bring it together, integrate it, so that we can describe what we have done with this $500 million to learn about our environment and the effects of oil and how to respond in a subsequent, I hope there isn't one as serious, but there are continuing spills, small ones, but nevertheless, it's important to understand how to respond to a spill, whether it's a very small one or a very large one. Not only do we have the legacy of the journals and publications, but as I say, it's really critical. This is one of the special issues of oceanography that's just appeared in the last few weeks. We have an annual meeting which was held in New Orleans in February, and it'll be in New Orleans again next year in 2018 in New Orleans, and we have about 1,100, over 1,000 participants. We hope that this will continue to be carried out by the National Academy of Science, which has a 30-year funding of $500 million over 30 years, and that the meeting that has turned out to be hugely informative and participatory by all of the funding groups that are working in the Gulf to come together to share their findings. Now, I'd like to close by giving you a viewing of what our filming group calls the sizzle. That is the preliminary bit of what's going to be in the next Dispatches from the Gulf. Oh, there we go.
Search continues for 11 people who were on a drilling platform when it exploded.
The Deepwater Horizon is now burning and listing about 40 miles off the coast of Louisiana.
This spill would eclipse the Exxon Valdez disaster in Alaska back in 1989.
As long as the oil is flowing down here in the Gulf, this will simply keep growing and growing and growing, and they have no idea where the end will be.
This is one of the first oil spills where enough resources have been put aside to study it for 10 years after the spill.
Why are so many dolphins in the Gulf of Mexico losing their young? Why are so many pregnancies failing in the wake of the Deepwater Horizon oil spill? Woo!
I'm actually using DNA barcoding to look at gut contents of unidentifiable fish. I guess I'm a fish detective.
We're looking at sites that had different amounts of oil contamination during the spill to determine whether there are differences in the composition of the communities of animals that live in sediments.
This is really the first step in making the marine snow. When we started this, we didn't know it was going to work as well as it has worked.
Finding out which microbes are responsible for breaking down oil in the environment is going to be critical for understanding how to deal with oil spills as they inevitably will happen in the future.
We're trying to build systems that could mimic what happens in the ocean.
We have the ability to produce the same conditions in this laboratory that are in the deep sea at the blowout. You know, it's like sitting on the floor of the ocean and watching the droplets and bubbles that are rising under these extreme conditions.
Oh my goodness, what is that?
It's a spark whale.
Oh, wow.
There are many things about the marine mammals, and especially the deep diving marine mammals of the northern Gulf of Mexico, that we didn't know prior to the spill.
There'll be two ships, three planes, and they need to be coordinated.
The purpose of our cruise here is to look at how oil might spread in a future oil spill.
Small craft
advisory
in effect.
We're going to get bounced around a little bit.
Keep going.
This is a new area that was never explored before.
Our research group studies the cardiac impacts of oil on the fish, especially looking at the heart.
I measure metrics of cardiovascular function to look at how the heart performs before oil exposure and after oil exposure.
We have some evidence that after fish have been exposed to oil, their sense of smell is diminished.
We're learning a lot more about what happened to the oil, how much damage did it do, and its lingering effects on the environment.
You got a big fish. Big six gill. I bet she's 1,000 pounds at least.
There we go.
This is what we live for, what we work for, all the time spent behind the computer.
Bye.
We only do that really so we can get out here.
Look at her, she's gonna swim right off.
It's really exciting to see how all the pieces come together, where all these different people are involved and all these components.
You want to make decisions from an informed viewpoint. You want to know what the truth is. What was the impact of the spill?
This story is going to play out for many years to really understand what was the long-term impact of the spill.
I'm Matt Damon, coming soon on Journey to Planet Earth. Dispatches from the Gulf.
So that's our effort to make sure that the average person knows how scientists work and what it is that we do. It's exciting, and it's at times it's tedious, but it's always adventuresome. So I think the message that I think that is important for me to convey is that we scientists have to spend time and effort to make sure that we tell the public what it is that we do. Now, we've already distributed the first dispatches from the Gulf, documentary number one. That's available and it's shown on a variety of screens around the country. And dispatches number two will be coming soon. And by the way, Matt Damon does this entirely gratis. We don't pay him anything. He is part of the team of Hal and Marilyn Weiner who do Journey to Planet Earth. And they do the documentaries for us and Matt Damon does the narration. So I want to close by simply saying that here we took an unfortunate incident, but it demonstrates how industry can get research done with academics and with the public to be able to understand and carry out extremely excellent research, focused, but still basic research, and do it in a way that addresses a very serious problem.
Thank you, Dr. Colwell. Next up, we're going to have a newly minted movie star whom you just saw, and that is Dr. Michael Schluter, who is going to be talking about implications with respect to pressure and temperature.
Yeah, thank you so much, Nancy, for this nice introduction. It was the first time for me to be in such a movie. And yeah, indeed, it's really an amazing experience to work with so many scientists from different regions all over the world and different topics together. I'm from the Institute of Multiphase Flows at Hamburg University of Technology, Michael Schluter, my name, and I'm the PI of a group that is working on the implications of pressure and temperature on the behavior of deep sea blowouts. And of course, I have not done the work. I have the pleasure now to present you some of the results. Our group consists of several PhD students and scientists who are working in the United States, Claire Paris from the University of Miami, in Australia, Zach Emmon from Canada. We have Steve Larter, and also we are three groups who are coming from the University of Technology in Hamburg. So I would like to take you on a journey now down to the deep sea, and would like to explain you more in detail what's happened in the blowout and what can we learn from this results that we had found there. First of all, we have already heard about this terrible accident in the Gulf of Mexico, and the motivation for us from the scientific point of view is now to help to get this insufficient science basis that was not able to support the response strategy for the Deepwater Horizon accident, to get better informations for this response strategies. So there were several insufficient science bases. For example, there were these deep sea conditions down 1,500 meters down the ocean. And this means that we have unknown effects, for example, on hydrate formation. You remember the very big problem to shut down the well. And furthermore, there were untested subsurface dispersant injections without any experience on that. And also, there were very much known about the biodegradability of the oil. And also, the topic of marine oil snow sedimentation has already not known so far. All this together was the motivation to come to a development of an enhanced response strategies by means of integrated modeling. So important for us in this Sea Image Consortium was to bring together the knowledge from the deep sea blowout to the rising behavior of the methane bubbles and droplets into the far field. And this should a little bit illustrate what we are talking about. So I would like to bring you to a journey of single oil droplets now. First, we're starting at the blowout preventer, the broken blowout preventer, what happens in the deep sea with oil and gas. Then oil and gas is transported through the plume and the near and far field into the ocean. And as you can see from this models here, we have already some achievements to predict how the oil is distributed in the deep sea. For example, the sizes of the droplets can already be calculated with a V-drop-J model by Michel Bouffedel. Then we have Scott Sokolowski from Texas A&M, who is able to calculate with the Tamak model how the oil is distributed in the plume and how intrusion layers are appearing here. And furthermore, we have the model from Claire Paris from the University of Miami, who is able to calculate the far field distribution of oil and how the hydrocarbons are dissolved in the ocean. So we have already a lot of very nice information, and it's a highly integrated model that helps us to determine the distribution of oil, so from the particle size over the plume, the near field, the far field, with data from the currents in the ocean, everything is taken into account with a very high complexity. And here you can see from this nice numerical simulation from Claire Paris how the oil is distributed in the Gulf of Mexico at different days. And she also takes into account with this oil connectivity modeling system the influences on the environment. So very highly integrated, but it looks very nice, but at the end, all the models are needing one important databases, and this is the size of the oil droplets and the size of the gas bubbles, because the size of the particles is important to predict their velocity and how the particles are spread in the near field and the far field. But how can we get information about the sizes of droplets and particles, about their velocities, directly at the wellhead? This is the initial important basis for all the other modeling. And therefore, it's important to estimate size and velocity range of the oil droplets. And so I would like to go down together with you to the deep sea ground. And the big question is, how is particle size distribution, the particles of oil that are effluent here from the wellhead, how is this affected by pressure? And we have heard about this several times before, how does dispersants are affecting that? And it's not very easy to predict what happens under 150 bars that we have here at the sea ground in 1,500 meter depth. So the particles are moving from this high pressure to the low pressure at the sea surface. What happens with the oil droplet that is under these conditions? And furthermore, it's more complicated because at the blowout preventer, you have already seen by Nancy, this blowout preventer has been broken at the Deepwater Horizon catastrophe, and this causes a pressure drop in the blowout preventer of about 90 bars. So what happens with the oil particle that goes through a broken blowout preventer with a pressure drop of 90 bars? Nobody knows this in detail, but probably this will have a strong influence on the droplet size distribution. So to show this a little bit more clear, we have 240 bars at the beginning of the blowout preventer. The oil goes through this system, and then we end up at the seaground at about 150 bars, which means we will have a sudden pressure drop, a sudden release of pressure in the blowout preventer, and then a slow linear decrease in pressure from the seaground to the sea level. And this pressure should have an influence on the oil particle. We don't know this in detail, and therefore we need some more information first. Of course, the oil itself is incompressible, but at the wellhead, we have not just the oil. The oil is saturated with methane, and this is what I would like to show you now. We have at the blowout a gas-to-oil ratio of 1,600 square cubic feet per barrel oil, which means the oil is saturated at the blowout with natural gas. And this natural gas, as you can see from this data from Ready, is almost methane. So we can say we have an almost methane saturated oil at the wellhead. And if we look on this data from the University of Calgary concerning the saturation of oil with methane, then you can see we have a quite high saturation with methane at the high pressure, but with decreasing pressure, the saturation concentration of methane in the oil droplets decreases. So what does it mean? This means we have an oil droplet saturated with methane, and then we release the pressure, so the methane has to go somewhere, right? And with decreasing pressure, we will lose the saturation of about 26 gram methane per liter oil. So this methane has to go somewhere. But where and how does it work? And exactly this is something that we explored in Hamburg at our pressure facility. So if the saturation concentration decreases with decreasing pressure, what's happening with the oil droplet? And to study this in more detail, because it's extremely difficult to predict the behavior of a saturated oil droplet under pressure release, we designed in Hamburg at the Institute of Professor Dieter Krause and his PhD student Karen Malone this pressure facility. This is a high pressure facility that enables us to have the same conditions like on the seafloor. So at 150 bars, it's driven with artificial seawater. And here we have a facility that can be introduced into this high pressure vessel to study let's say mini deep sea blowout under artificial well-defined conditions. And this is how it looks like inside. We have the nozzle here where the oil is distributed into the system. We are working with two cameras, one high-speed camera from this side with a mirror here, looks on the system itself. And we have an endoscopic system that is located inside of the plume to measure particle size distributions of the oil inside of this artificial plume. And here you can see the nozzle where the oil exits. This is another nozzle where core exits, so the dispersant can be injected. And this is the endoscope to measure the particle size distribution. We did hundreds of experiments with different kinds of pressures, temperatures, and also with so-called dead oil, so oil without the saturation of methane. And with oil that is saturated with methane, we call this live oil because it's much more realistic than the dead oil experiment. We used Louisiana sweet crude oil from BP Sarrogate, and we pre-saturated the oil in such a vessel with the methane. And I would like to show you how this looks like. So here in the middle, we have the dead oil jet. This means oil without methane saturation. We have here a well-known angle of how the oil exits this jet. And as you can see on the right-hand side, if we have live oil, so with saturated methane, then you get a much bigger angle of excess here. And this is for sure because the oil is expanding suddenly after the release. Yeah, and this expanding comes from the gas that will expand if the pressure is released suddenly. So, and you can see here additionally methane bubbles, of course, because the gas is released by this pressure drop. So on the left-hand side, you can see the measurement of the particle size distribution in yellow. Here we have an automatic image analysis, and this is a particle size distribution for the dead oil that is in a good agreement with other experiments, for example, from Sintef in Norway. And on the image below, you can see the live oil experiment. And unfortunately, we have been not able so far to measure the particle size distribution of the live oil because the particles are much smaller and they are looking different than oil droplets. It's more a fluffy substance. And this is because we have a kind of a foaming effect by the methane. It's like an emulsification. So the distribution is definitely much smaller than compared to the dead oil, but it's difficult to get the particle size distribution so far. And if you look on the colored images, then you will probably agree with me that these live oil jet in our laboratory looks very close concerning the color to the jet at the real Deepwater Horizon blowout. So this sudden pressure drop over the wellhead obviously leads to a very rapid degassing and a kind of emulsification of the oil. And because this is the same effect, you know, from your kitchen at home, if you are preparing a cappuccino by bringing steam into the milk, this is very similar to the effect what happens here with the expanding gas in the oil. It looks very much like a cappuccino, and Stephen Murawski called this, because of that, the cappuccino effect. This is the cappuccino effect that gives us these emulsified oil at the wellhead. So if we look once again on our graph, we are at this point where we have this sudden pressure drop, and this sudden pressure drop leads to this kind of degassing, or let's say a kind of explosion of the oil droplets directly at the oil exits the wellhead. And this is actually an effect that had not been taken account so far, because it was not possible to make experiments under these high-pressure conditions. So the big question is now, if we have already this emulsification process, what happens if we add dispersants? Do we get a better dispersion with this corrected system or not? And I will show you another movie to make this more clear. Here we have once again the live oil jet without corrected, without the dispersants. And on the right-hand side, it's just separated by this red line. We have the same situation, but in this case, with corrected. One second, I will start it again. As you can see, I don't know what's going on here. Okay, don't want to run again, but I guess you already could see that on the right-hand side, the live oil jet with corrected looks very similar to the live oil jet on the left-hand side. So obviously, the addition of dispersants makes no additional significant effect on the particle size distribution. And this is, of course, a very important effect that obviously it has to be taken into account whether we have this emulsification process for the oil or not. But this is not the end of the story, because we have a longer way of the oil droplets from the wellhead to the surface. And the question is, if we have these oil gas-saturated oil droplets and it's moving through the water column, what happens with the oil droplet afterwards? And especially, what is the velocity of the oil droplets, which is a very important input parameter for all the modeling. So how is the rise velocity affected by pressure? If the pressure is during the rise journey decreasing from 150 bars to 1 bar, and this is the illustration for that. So this droplet is now going to the sea level and reaches at the end 1 bar pressure. And to study the effect of the degassing, we used another facility in Hamburg. And this is a high-pressure cell. You can see this here in the middle. And in this high-pressure cell, we have the possibility to introduce a countercurrent flow, countercurrent to the rising velocity of the oil droplet. And here you can see the oil droplet in the countercurrent flow. And now the trick is that we release a pressure in this system from 150 bars to ambient pressure. In the same velocity how the droplet gets the pressure release. And as you can see, with decreasing pressure, this droplet is expanding, and especially at the end, it expands very strongly, and you can see these tiny methane bubbles that are appearing within the droplet. So obviously, with decreasing pressure, the methane is expanding within the droplet, and this, of course, also affects the droplet size and droplet density, and also the droplet rising velocity. So this effect is well known from the decompression sickness from diving. You know that divers have a high saturation concentration in the blood if they are in the deep, and if they are coming up, then they have to avoid that gas bubbles are appearing in the bloodstream. This is extremely dangerous, and therefore you have to stop at a different depth to make sure that all the gas is in equilibrium and you have no outgassing in the bloodstream, and therefore this is a very similar effect. And here you can see how the gas bubbles are increasing in the droplet, and so the whole oil droplet will increase and the density will decrease. This is a calculation that shows the particle diameter increases, the particle density decreases, and the gas void fraction within the droplet increases. And now you can calculate the rising velocity, and you can see that the droplets are accelerating if they are going to the surface. And we have for this live oil droplet a rising time that is just the half, with 6 hours, compared to the dead oil droplet rise velocity. So I would like to summarize my talk now. So I've shown you that we have already a highly integrated model that helps us to take into account all these physical properties, which is very nice. But on the other hand, there are several physical effects, like this cappuccino effect or the degassing, that has to be investigated more in detail and that has to be taken into account in these models. And especially the subsurface dispersion injection is a very important point that have to be, we have to look for that very carefully, because it might be useless if we have already an emulsification process at the wellhead. And so in the future, we have to calculate particle size distributions more carefully by taking into account pressure release as well as turbulent kinetic energy. And so I would like to come back to the question from Nancy from the beginning. What do we need to know to effectively regulate and respond to accidents associated with ultra-deep drilling and production? And from our scientific point of view, first of all, we have to feed the models with reliable data. And therefore, it's necessary to know the depth of the blowouts, oil properties, the volume flow rate to calculate turbulent kinetic energy ratios. The gas to oil ratio is important, and also the pressure drop over the blowout preventer is very important. If we know all these data, then we can feed the models and we can predict how oil will distribute in the water column. And this hopefully will help to get oil development policies to come to better risk evaluations, because we can predict how oil will spread at a certain oil spill. And this will also help to calculate the height of insurances for drilling rigs at certain positions in the ocean, and also, of course, to develop further response strategies. And I hope this is really a very important legacy of the Deepwater Horizon. So I would like to thank you for your attention. The model is much more complicated. We are also dealing with hydrate formation and also biodegradation under pressure, but this is too much for one presentation. Therefore, I would like to thank all our partners that have been worked on this scientific outcomes, and especially I would like to thank the Gulf of Mexico Research Initiative for financing this project. Thank you very much.
Our final speaker before we open this up for discussion is Dr. Steve Murawski, and he is going to be talking about some of the biological work that has been done. Steve?
Thanks. Thank you, Nancy. I'm extremely jealous of Michael having a warm-up back of Dr. Colwell and Matt Damon. I mean, come on. So what I would like to do is, in 20 minutes, is describe $1 billion worth of ecological research. Pretty heady task here. So seriously, what I'd like to do is talk to you a little bit about the approaches that scientists have used to do the ecological impact assessments, not only of the issues that Michael talked about, but also the impacts on ecological resources, both now and future impacts. Secondly, talk about some research strategies that have been used to do this ecological research, not only in Deepwater Horizon, but also to revisit the other major blowout that occurred in the Gulf of Mexico back in 1979 and 1980, which was the Ixtoc 1 blowout that happened in Campeche. Third, I'd like to talk about some of our research results. And again, this is going to be a microcosm of the massive amounts of research. I'd like to also tee this issue up about the resiliency of ecosystems to these kinds of massive phenomena. And last, I want to put up a list of what I consider to be unresolved science issues that make this really important to consider in terms of public policy. So when we think about the research toolbox that we all have to do these kinds of studies of an event like Deepwater Horizon, there are really only five things that we do. And all of the studies, the 800 or 900 publications, they fall into one or more of these bins. That is, since the oil spill, we've done a lot of in situ surveying and monitoring. A lot of sort of, you know, after the horse has left the barn, you know, what's left over kind of thing. And that's certainly important because it basically allows us to look at, you know, return to whatever the baseline was. On the top right, you see the sort of laboratory-based experimentation, and there's a really great example that Michael gave of the importance of the understanding the fundamental physics and chemistry of an event like that. And the reason is not so much to sort of go back and see what happened, but what happens when we have the next blowout, and it's not at 1,500 meters, but it's at 3,000 meters. I mean, what's your basis to actually say what's going to happen? Is it analogy to what happened at 1,500 meters? Probably not. because of the extreme temperature conditions, the hydrate formation issues, they're going to be vastly different. So this interplay between laboratory experimentation and modeling is absolutely critical if we're going to leave a legacy of science that's useful for the next time, and there will be a next time this happens. Field-based experiments, not so much, but there have been some manipulative experiments that people have done. For example, the interaction of the impacts of the oil on communities of animals like fishes and the simultaneous growth of invasive lionfish in the system. We can do manipulative experiments by taking the lionfish out to see what, for example, the recovery rate of some of these underlying populations are. And lastly, this notion of comparative spatial analysis. And you know, one of the axioms of this kind of science in search of baselines is that you can substitute space for time. That is, you can find a place that necessarily wasn't affected by a situation like this, and even though you can't turn back the clock to pre-blowout and get some information, perhaps you can find a place that's similar enough that you can make analogies to. So all of the science that people have done and will be doing really fall into these kinds of bins. And it's really the combinations of these various modalities of science, the epistemology of science, that really allows us a much more powerful learning environment. Talked about laboratory experimentation and numerical modeling. In situ surveying in laboratory, for example, a lot of the exposure testing, you know, we can expose an animal that's never been exposed to oil, look at what the implications are, but it's more powerful when we actually look at the contaminant loads in those specimens out in nature, so you can try to interpret the ecological effects. So this diagram, it's called the Physiological Oil Spill Response Constellation, or the PORC diagram, actually explains at least what's been done for about $1 billion. And it includes not only Gomery's research that relates to ecological effects, but also the Natural Resource Damage Assessment, which is basically the process by which penalties are assessed against the responsible party, in this case BP and others. And the way this is read is color coding is the different kinds of species that are involved in all the types of studies that have gone on. So you see, for example, marine mammals are in cyan, and sea turtles are in green, and birds are in red, and fish are in orange, and crustaceans are in purple, I guess. So all the places where you have dots, individual studies have been have worked in that area. And so it starts with the water oil droplet, which basically is the pathways in which ecological resources have been affected. And it's either through the sediment, that is, you know, animals in or on the sediment. It's through the air. Many of the marine mammals that were shown in the movie got a heavy dose of aspirated hydrocarbons, you know, by breathing them, through the water, obviously water contact, and then up the food chain through food. So the way you sort of look at this diagram is in the inner circle here, these are basically the pathways in which oil is exposed. The inner constellation, the sort of Mercury and other planets, these are sort of the organismal and cellular level effects. Again, going to the organism, but then we're starting to look at, you know, what affects vital functions of the animal. So from this part of the sort of the Saturn and Jupiter, this is where you get to the population level and in fact the community level. So this $1 billion worth of research has actually worked in all of these different areas. So I wanted to illustrate one example of the importance of new technologies for oil spill research. Now, prior to Deepwater Horizon, the general statistic that people calculated was so-called LC50s. That is the lethal dose at which 50% of an animal population was exposed actually died. But as you could see from the work on the mammals, we're much more concerned these days with these so-called sublethal effects. And that is, you know, what continues to be problematic for the organisms in the environment. So this particular diagram, and I won't go through the details, but it was a blue crab study where they looked at three bins. They looked at just the water itself, so natural conditions, water and oil, and water and dispersants. And what this this diagram looks at is the gene expression, both upregulated and downregulated genes in the different trials. And what it basically shows is that with the oil and the dispersants, you've got a lot of downregulated genes. And because there is a gene map for blue crabs, We know that these genes control a lot of the important functions in the animal. For example, energy transfer, cell division, apoptosis, which is cell death, defense against diseases, et cetera. And so we can really start to understand from these sort of application of new technologies something fundamental about the mechanism as opposed to just, for example, LC50. So one thing I mentioned early on was the Ixtoc 1 oil spill that occurred in 1979 and 1980. The spill ran for 9 months. It had about two-thirds the volume of Deepwater Horizon. And we were able to do some satellite data archaeology, and actually there was a satellite called Coastal Zone Color Scanner that flew the year before that spill. We were actually able to go back and get the imagery from the Coastal Zone Color Scanner and basically provide a surface map of the oil expression similar to the one that many people have worked on with Deepwater. And this is important because this sort of, in our parlance, gave us a treasure map of where to actually look for potential oil residue that might still be in the environment. So one of the questions, of course, is, you know, if we all learned in fourth grade that oil floats, why are we looking for it on the sea bottom? And this is actually one of the fundamental discoveries of Gomery, and that is that a substantial quantity of that oil rests on the sea bottom, anywhere from 4 to 10%. There's been a few estimates a little bit higher. So, you know, again, what is the mechanism that would otherwise bring, you know, something that has a density much lighter than water back down to the bottom to basically create issues there? And so a lot of the research that my colleagues and I have been doing is actually punching holes in the bottom to see if we can find the oil and then see what it actually looks like. So these are two cores. One, the one on the left-hand side is a sediment core from the Deepwater Horizon area. And so you see this sort of light brown, typical mud sediments in 1,500 meters of water. And then you see this redox zone here, which is basically manganese oxide in the presence of oxygen, black. And then this is a sediment core from the area around the Ixtoc spill. And this was actually taken two summers ago. And so what you see is the same redox boundary, but then it's basically been landfilled under about 6 centimeters of sediment. The interesting thing, of course, is that we can actually not only get an idea of and do the sediment core dating, but also look at the ecology of the animals that are captured within that sediment layer. So this idiom of geological science is that we can go from something the past can be the key to the past is actually predicting the future. And this, so by doing these studies in the southern Gulf of Mexico, potentially we can see what the Deepwater Horizon trapped oil on the bottom might look like 37 years from now. Right. So if you take the satellite map of Deepwater Horizon surface expression, it looks something like this, and you've seen that. But this is what our map of the bottom of the ocean looks like from sediment cores. What we're finding is that we have a number of areas of relatively high concentration of oil on the bottom. But because it's perched on a bathymetry, a very steep bathymetry, as Michael showed the model, it's actually rolling downhill. And so what we're seeing is that in the bottom of these deposition centers, the actual amount of hydrocarbons is going up as this sort of semi-solid, you know, drifts down the bathymetry. So not only do we get an idea of what's on the bottom, but we've coined this term called MOFSA, which is marine oiled sediment and flocculation. I can't quite get the acronym. It doesn't twist in the mouth very well. But the point is, with the oil coming up through layers of the ocean and the use of dispersants, basically you've created dead plankton, and as they die, they express these sort of sticky EPS substances. And that, in combination with the oil, is and the sediments coming from the river deltas is heavy enough to actually sink it. So we think that the process where the oil got to the bottom is this marine oiled snow. And there's a whole variety of things that we've been able to discern, you know, from not only the sediment cores themselves, but also collecting the planktic foraminifera, et cetera. And one of the important aspects of this is how long does it take for the sediment to recover so that we see normal benthic processes? And so we can glean this not only from the Ixtoc case, and so it took about 7 years for normal benthic processes to start, but we're also doing time series work in the Deepwater Horizon. You can see that it's actually been a little bit quicker. Right, so we've seen some recovery of the sediment community in the bottom. So I want to switch the focus up the food chain a little bit and talk a little bit about fishes, which is actually my specialty. So with the funding from the Gulf of Mexico Research Initiative, we've been doing fish-related work since 2011. Most of our work has been up in the north central Gulf of Mexico around Deepwater, and so we've got a time series of fish data, and I'll show you a little bit of that. But we've also been able to circumnavigate the Gulf and work down in the Ixtoc region and actually the entirety of the Gulf of Mexico in these sub-ecosystems like the West Florida Shelf, the Northwest Gulf, the Campeche area, and the Yucatan. So this is basically the abundance of animals that we've taken in those regions. I said before that, you know, we've been working in the north central Gulf of Mexico. So this looks at contaminant levels in an iconic species in the Gulf, the red snapper. And you can see that these are red snapper, the concentration of naphthalene metabolites in the gallbladder or the bile of red snapper. And you can see there's a very substantial decline over that period of time. Although, as I said before, with the sediments, we see some sort of you know, changes that it's not necessarily an exponential decline to a lower baseline. And then we can also compare north and south. So this is the northern Gulf of Mexico versus the southern Gulf of Mexico in terms of the contamination rate. Other symptoms that we saw in the field, one of the most visible things that the fishermen brought to us early on was the notion that a lot of the animals had these gross-looking skin lesions on them. And so the question became, you know, is this just because people are, you know, looking harder, you know, as opposed to, was this a symptomology of exposure, basically a toxicokinetic outcome? And so we've been monitoring these things over time as well, and lo and behold, what you see is that the percent of animals with skin lesions has also dropped to, basically, we don't see any animals anymore that have these. And so it's not proof positive that that happened, but it certainly is a smoking gun at this point in terms of what's gone on. And I'll tell you that it's been backed up by laboratory studies, which have indicated that you can induce these skin lesions on fish by not only exposing them to oil, but high levels of bacteria, which is exactly what happened because of the amping up of the bacterial load. So some of the other issues or things that we can do with the data are also look at the, you know, the spatial comparisons. And this is a fairly important graphic because this looks at the fish bile stuff that it had for red snapper, but basically does it for all the stations that we've had around the Gulf of Mexico. And what you see is that in the Deepwater Horizon area, the concentrations of naphthalene metabolites is very high. I mean, this is 420,000 parts per billion, or 420 parts per million, which is very high. And so you see it in other parts of the Gulf. And so one would argue maybe, for example, it was argued during Deepwater Horizon that, this is the fact that it's an oily Gulf. You've got natural seeps in the Gulf, and you've got, you know, the oil industry that Nancy showed. So if you plot those things over this diagram, the blue is the natural seeps and the cyan are the actual oil industry platforms, you can see there's lots of area that have neither, but they do have high levels of PAHs. So I'm going to skip a couple things. One of the things that we can do from the data that we have is also look at the potential resiliency of the animals related to the complexity of the ecosystem. So this graphic compares at a given length the number of different species that we're able to take in the surveying that we've done. And what you see is that for a given size interval, like at a meter long, fairly large snappers and groupers, you have a much more diverse fish community in the northern Gulf than the southern Gulf. And why is that important? If you have something like an oil spill, you're much more likely to have functional redundancy in the system. That is, animals that operate at the same trophic level and do the same things, as opposed to, you know, a very lean community. The other part of the biota I want to describe, and I'm almost done here, is the notion of, you know, how this spill happened and, of course, you know, where it happened. It was the first really mega blowout in a mile deep. And one of the communities of very much underappreciated at the time was this sort of deep pelagic community, which includes both the benthopelagic and the mesopelagic animals. And these communities include a lot of fishes. In fact, this group called Depend, which is one of the centers that is funded by Dr. Colwell, has actually compiled more species than were known to actually exist in the Gulf of Mexico. And I think their goal is to actually name 60 new species, just because the region had never been really explored. So if this is the new norm about where the industry is, we need to know much more about the communities potentially at risk. And it's not just fishes, it's crustaceans, jellies, squids, and certainly microbes. So the last little bit I wanted to talk about, and we'll go to questions, is, you know, if we look around the Gulf, you know, how could we actually describe the potential resiliency of different communities around the Gulf to something like a blowout or a hurricane, et cetera? So there are a number of attributes that we could look at. We could look at the population demography. For example, you know, what is the span of age groups in red snapper? And they're going to be more resilient if you have a lot more adult fish of different age groups, you know, to a one-time event like an oil spill than if they were all young fish. What's the level of biodiversity? What's the overall level of primary productivity in the system? Where are the unique species that you find in one subarea versus others? And this notion of adjacency is, if you lost a species or a group of species in an area, are there adjacent examples of the same species that could recruit back into it? So these are the things that we're trying to work on in terms of informing not only what happened in the deep water, but also how might we inform the process of actually citing places and taking other locations off of the table because they are vulnerable marine ecosystems. So, as I said before, there are an enormous number of what I would consider unresolved policy important issues. Certainly the issue of baselines. I mean, almost every ecological paper published about Deepwater Horizon ends with, well, the job would have been a lot easier if we had environmental baselines of fish and quality and spatial resolution to do the job. Now, we have a bunch of baselines, but they're general baselines. Remember, Nancy showed the map of where these facilities are, and that those locations will be where the next accident is, right? So, but we don't have site-specific baselines. We have these general things, right? So clearly, you know, this is an unresolved government-related issue, right? The efficacy and pre-authorization for SSDI, which is subsurface dispersant injection. The talk that Michael gave highlights this issue of what fraction of those small droplets, which never got to the surface, which were dispersed, was created by the natural processes versus the subsurface injection of almost 800,000 gallons of dispersants, right? And so this is probably the hottest issue we have right now. Another issue is the independence of the peer review process for controversial oil spill response strategies. And that is, you know, you've got very controversial things. You've got a regulated industry that's politically very active. So where do we get the sort of independence that steps back and says, we're going to be evidence-based in terms of making decisions here, and this is very critical. The siting of facilities near vulnerable marine ecosystems, obviously very important. During the spill, there were a lot of what we would call ad hoc response measures. For example, opening up sluice ways to let a lot of fresh water out with the idea of trying to push the oil off, the creation of sand berms, et cetera. How do we actually, you know, can we get a handle on these so that next time this happens, we can push back against things that may not be efficacious, let's say that. And then, of course, you know, all of these industries, both Mexican industry, the U.S. industry, and now the Cuban industry, they're all merging to the center, which means one of these accidents is going to be right in the middle of it. And so how do we actually collaborate across international lines? So with that.